Good morning po sa lahat ng criminology students, sa lahat ng nagre-review for the upcoming criminology licensure examination under the new curriculum. Sa Luzon, Visayas at sa Mindanao, welcome po sa last pangatlong discussion natin sa subject na Human Rights Education. Okay, human rights education, a subject under criminal law and jurisprudence. Do not be surprised, cadets, bakit may tatlong episode po tayo? Kasi ang human rights education comprises a lot of topics. Okay, a lot of topics. Hindi naman po pwedeng we just discuss it in 20 to 30 minutes. Kailangan po comprehensive yung discussion natin para at least maintindihan, okay? Maintindihan at makuha yung mga kailanganin na mga impormasyon na magagamit niyo sa upcoming criminology licensure examination. So sa episode po na ito will be a continuation of the Bill of Rights, particularly on Section 10 na po tayo. Section 10, then we will also discuss the rights of the PDL, tapos yung rights of the child in conflict with the law, pati na yung rights of the cultural minorities, at yung pinakalast would be the function or the role of the Philippine Commission on Human Rights. Now, ang pang-sampo na human right talks about contracts. No law impairing the obligation of contracts shall be passed. We will define first what is obligation of contract para maintindihan. Ang obligation of contract po, ibig sabihin dyan, duty which binds the parties to perform their agreement according to its terms or intent, if it is not contrary to law, morals, good customs, public order, and public policy. Ang agreement po dyan, na notarized, na memorandum of agreement, for example, ang tawag po dyan, obligation of contract. Kung ano ang nasabi sa agreement, like for example, part of the agreement would say, I pay 10,000 per month. Then, that is your obligation. Because that is part that is reflected in that court contract that you signed for. When does a contract become impaired? Anong ibig sabihin na impaired? Na wala na pong bisa. Okay? When its terms or conditions are changed by law or by a party without the consent of the other, thereby weakening the position of rights of the latter. For example, naging author ka ng libro, tapos part ng agreement nyo sa publishing company, tapos ikaw na author, ang sabi dyan, agreement is you as the author should not publish the same book to another publishing company. Pero ang ginawa mo, ginamit mo ang same manuscript, nag-change ka lang ng title, tapos nag-publish ka sa another publishing company. That is a violation of the contract. In that case, na-impaired na po yung kontrata nyo. Ikaw na author at saka yung publishing company. Okay? Now, I think sa lahat ng mga rights under Article 3, I think ang pinaka-importante dito ang Section 11. Okay? Section 11, cadets. This talks about the right to free access to the services of the courts and quasi-judicial bodies. Meaning, there should be legal assistance irrespective of circumstances that you have in life. Especially those persons who are poor. Wala pong kapera-pera yung pobre po na mga kapatiran natin na Pinoy. Na kung minsan pumunta sa korte, walang pera. Walang pambayad sa transportation. Diba? Walang pambayad. Pag nag-file ng kaso, wala talagang pera. Walang pang-acceptance fee. So, ang sabi po dito sa Section 11, dapat they can also avail to the free access of the courts and quasi-judicial bodies and of course, the adequate legal assistance. Kaya po, meron tayong public attorney's office.
Kahit sa public attorney's office, kung pumunta po kayo sa Dumaguete City, pumunta kayo sa PAW, napakaganda po kasi pag nagpanotarize ka, wala pong bayad. And if you do not, if you will complain on something, you can ask assistance from the PAW. Okay? From the PAW, because I would have to laud the public attorney's office in Dumaguete City. They are very good, I tell you, in terms of legal assistance. And they're very quick to assist you on legal matters. Now, sa Section 11 po, nakalagay din po yan, sa Section 11, kasama na po yan, yung constitutional rights of the accused. Okay? Diba, sabi ko kanina, dapat may, I will be discussing to you about constitutional rights of the accused. Ito na po. Ang first, second, and third one, tinatawag po yung Miranda rights. Diba? Cadets, I think you are already familiar about this. Ang right to counsel, yan po ang number one. Legal assistance, right to counsel. Right to be informed of the cause and nature of accusation. Right to remain silent. Tawag po dyan, mga Miranda rights po yan. Now, ang tanong ngayon, sa tatlong Miranda rights, saan po dyan ang di po pwede mong ma-waived? Di po pwedeng ma-surrender? Saan po dyan? Right to remain silent? Right to be informed of the cause and nature of accusation, or the right to counsel? Yun po at itong Miranda rights. Ang tanong, saan po dyan ang pwede at hindi pwedeng ma-waived or ma-surrender? Pag right to silence, right to remain silent, tanong, pwede ba ma-surrender o hindi? The answer is pwede. Pwede po mong ma-waive. That is why we have confession and admission. Kasi pwede kang mag-confess. Pag nag-confess ka, ulit, nag-surrender ka sa right mo to remain silent. Right to counsel. You do not want to be assisted by a lawyer because you will be lawyering yourself in the court. Pwede bang ma-waive? Pwede. Pwedeng ma-surrender mo yan. Pero ang right to be informed, hindi po pwedeng sabihin mo nga, Your Honor, I will waive my right to be informed. It is okay for me not to be informed about the crime I am accused in. Hindi po pwede. Why? In order for you to represent yourself in the court, you should know what particular crime you are charged with. Diba? Hindi po pwedeng sasabihin na court, okay, even if you do not know, you will be in prison. No, you have to know. And that is the reason why sa tatlong Miranda rights, yung right to be informed of the cause and nature of accusation, yan po ang right na hindi mo pwedeng ma-waive sa korte. Okay? Next, another right of the accused would be right against torture. Okay? Right against being held in secret, incommunicado, or similar forms of solitary detention. We say incommunicado, you are in a solitary confinement. Hindi ka talaga makapag-communicate to the outside world. For example, noong araw may tinatawag po tayong Bartolina. Diba? Meron tayong tinatawag na Bartolina. Ang Bartolina po is a violation of the human right kasi hindi po pwede yan. Alright? When you held a person in captive, isolate him, detain him in a very isolated place, hindi po pwede kasi it is a violation of his constitutional right. Dapat po, he has to be inside the jail. Okay? Next, right to bail. We will talk about bail later on. Right to due process of law. I already mentioned this a while ago. Right to presumption of innocence. Oh, ito, right to presumption of innocence. Pag ang tao committed a crime and is not yet arrested, ang tawag po dyan, suspect. Diba? He committed a crime. He is suspected to commit a crime. He has not been arrested. Tawag po dyan, suspect. Pag ang tao na-arrested na, and you started your interrogation, ang tawag po niya is accused. Okay? You already started your interrogation. The person has already been arrested. Ang tawag po dyan, accused. If ang person ay pumunta na sa korte to defend himself, ang tawag po niya is defendant. Nakuha niyo, cadets? defendant. Pag andyan na siya sa korte. Pag convicted na ang individual, ang tawag niya is criminal na. Why? Because he has already been convicted. Pag nandyan na siya sa jail or prison, ang tawag niya is persons deprived of liberty. PDL po ang tawag, ha? Hindi po inmate. Hindi po prisoner. Ang tawag sa correction manual, ang tawag po is PDL or persons deprived of liberty. So, kuha niyo po ang transition, suspect, accused, defendant, criminal to persons deprived of liberty. So, pag hindi pa po convicted, dapat yung tao should be presumed as innocent. Next, right to be heard by himself and counsel, right to speedy and impartial public trial. Ang tanong, sir, in the Philippines po, ang nangyayari, sometimes our cases will take to eternity. Diba? Yung mama sa pano masaker, wala pa ding resulta. Yung Maguindanao masaker, there was already a result, but it took a lot of years. Napakatagal po. Ang tanong, is it a violation of the right to speedy and impartial public trial? The answer is no. Why? Because we have to consider, cadets, number one, yung burden of work sa korte. Okay? Number two, yung evidences presented. Hindi po pwedeng the judge can just issue a verdict without considering these factors. Because at the end of the day, the person should be convicted if there is a strong evidence to prove beyond reasonable doubt that he committed the crime. Yan po. So that is why yung cases natin medyo tumagal dito sa Pilipinas. Tapos ko konti lang yung lawyer natin. Next, right to meet the witnesses face to face. Right to have compulsory process to secure the attendance of witnesses and the production of evidence in his behalf. Right against self-incrimination. We'll discuss self-incrimination later. Right against detention by reason of political beliefs. Hindi po pwede na yellow ang political color mo, tapos yung isa pink yung isa is red, yung isa is violet, yung isa is black, tapos ang nanalo is black, tapos pink ka, tapos naging detained ka because of your political color, hindi mo pwede yan because that is a violation of the human right under Article 3. Next, excessive fines is also a violation. Okay, so dapat you have to observe ang right na accused against excessive fines. Degrading, cruel, and inhuman punishment, hindi po pwede. Death penalty, hindi po pwede, except for heinous crime. Ang tanong ngayon, sir, mayroon pa ba tayong death penalty? Okay, mayroon pa ba tayong death penalty? The answer is no. Okay, we will discuss about death penalty later on. Pero ngayon, wala na tayong death penalty. Right against double jeopardy. Alright? We will also discuss about double jeopardy on the later sections of the discussion. So basically, those are the constitutional rights of the accused. Now, ang Section 12 is just a repetition on the rights of the accused. Repetition lang po yan. But for the sake of clarification and discussion, review na lang po natin. Yung number one po, it talks about right to remain silent and the right to counsel po. Dalawa lang po yan, ha. Ang sinasabi dyan, pwede mong ma-waive. Oh, these rights cannot be waived except in writing and in the presence of counsel. So meaning, pwede mong ma-waived. Basta, it should be in writing and in the presence of a counsel. Ang tanong, sir, I have the right to counsel pero wala pa akong pera. Okay? I don't have money. I cannot afford a lawyer. What will happen? If you cannot afford a lawyer, ganito ang mangyayari. Yung investigator ng krimen, siya po ang mag-provide sa iyo ng counsel. O ikaw, police, ikaw po ang mag-provide ng lawyer sa accused. Okay? Saan ka kukuha ng lawyer? Kukuha ka ng lawyer sa public attorney's office. So the accused will have to be assisted by the personnel coming from the public attorney's office. Lawyer din po yan. Now, sa number one, hindi po nakalagay yung right to be informed of the cause and nature of accusation. Bakit? Sa sinabi ko na kanina, hindi po pwede yang ma-waive. Yung dalawa lang, right to counsel at saka yung right to remain silent. Provided again that the counsel, that the waiver should be in writing and it should be done in the presence of the counsel. Counsel means yung lawyer po. Ang number two po talks about solitary confinement. As I mentioned a while ago, hindi po pwede yan. Yung incommunicado, secret detention, hindi po pwede. Pati yung torture, threat and intimidation, hindi po pwede. Yung number three naman, any confession or admission obtained in violation of this section 17 hereof shall be inadmissible in evidence against him. Now, para maintindihan, ano ba ibig sabihin ng admission at saka confession? Ang admission po is direct acknowledgement of guilt. Ang admission po is indirect admission of the guilt. Like you go to the police station, you tell the police officer that you committed the act. You write the whole story down. Ang tawag po dyan, confession. Pero pag nag-undergo ka pa ng interrogation, marami pang satsat yung police, hindi ka pa nag-confess. Tapos in a particular question, you confess something, tawag po dyan, admission. Indirect acknowledgement of the guilt. Now, ang pagkuha ng confession at admission, may mechanics din po yan, cadets, that you have to remember. Baka lalabas to sa board exam. Pag ang tao mag-confess sa iyo or mag-admit sa iyo, ito po ang dapat mong tandaan. Una, dapat voluntary yan. Pangalawa, dapat gagawin mo ang pag-confess or pag-admit in writing. It should be in writing. Number three, it should be done in the presence of the lawyer. And number four, the confession should be done in a language known to the subject. Pag hindi mo na meet ang mga requirements na yan, problemado ka, police officer ka. Kasi yung admission at confession mo, maging fruit of the poisonous tree yan. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng fruit of the poisonous tree? Any evidence that is illegally obtained is inadmissible in the court. Why? Kasi illegal yung pag-obtain mo. Bakit illegal? Kasi yung requirements hindi mo na-meet. So dapat ma-meet mo yung requirements. Now, ang confession po, dalawa po yan, klase. Judicial confession, extrajudicial confession yung pangalawa. Ano ang pagkakaiba sa dalawa? Ang judicial confession, ito po yung confession done inside the court. Yung extrajudicial confession po, done outside the court. Ang sinasabi ko kanina that you have to meet the requirements are part of what we call as extrajudicial confession. So, ibig sabihin po, sa extrajudicial confession, it has to be voluntary, it has to be in writing, it has to be in a language known to the subject, and it has to be signed by the counsel. So pag nag-confess po ang tao, pagpunta niya sa police station niyo, dapat yun po ang requirements na dapat mong i-meet or dapat mong i-observe. Sir, pag judicial confession, nag-confess po yung tao sa korte, kailangan pa bang in writing? Kailangan pa bang in the presence of the counsel? No need, kasi extrajudicial, ang judicial confession yan eh. Andyan ka na sa presence of the judge. Yung extrajudicial confession, kailangan mag-meet sa requirements kasi dapat you have to meet it para for the benefit of the judge. It's a judicial confession. Nandyan na yung judge. It has to be in writing, it has to be in the press. Nandiyan na naman yung counsel sa korte. So no need for that. But in the extrajudicial confession, kailanganin mo pong ma-meet yung requirements na yan. Ang last po, pag nakita ka na may violations of this section, ikaw yung police officer po ha, dito ang police officer po ang nag-violate. Diba? Usually ganito po ang mangyayari. You just you just put somebody in a, for example, in a solitary confinement, or you take the confession or admission based on brutal methods. Hindi po pwede yan, kasi pag nangyari po, violations will be penalized. So dapat po, tayo mga police officers, we have to be very careful about this. Now, ang section 13 talks about bail. Okay? Bail po ang tawag. Now, ang bail is basically a security. Security required by the court. Pero, ang sa bail po, nakalagay dyan that everyone who has been charged with an offense, okay, has been charged with an offense, can actually avail on the bail. And once you avail on the bail, you can be released temporarily. Okay? Para maintindihan natin ang section 13, tingnan natin uli kung ano ang ibig sabihin ng bail. Ang bail is a security required by a court and given for that provisional or temporary release. Release of a person who is in custody of the law, conditioned. Anong ibig sabihin ng condition? Meaning, you are required. May condition ka na dapat magpakita ka sa korte na required schedule. So, temporary lang po. Temporary release or provisional release. So, ang lahat ng tao na na-detain has the right of bail. Pero ang right to bail po is very limited. Kasi, kapag you committed a crime that is punishable by capital offense or reclusion perpetua. When you see capital offense, these are offenses punishable by death. Good thing that we no longer have death penalty. So, okay lang. Pero pag ang crimen is punishable by reclusion perpetua, like for example, murder, infanticide, aggravated to the highest or maximum penalty, ang mangyayari po, kasi reclusion perpetua, you will be disqualified to avail on the bail. Pero pag ang kaso mo or ang krimen mo is only punishable by prison correctional, arresto minor, arresto mayor, I mean, these are just lower from 20 years. So basically, you can avail to bail po because that is one of your rights provided in the Constitution. Ang Section 14 po is very basic, okay? It talks again about due process of law. You are not bound to answer unless there is a due process of law. Ang pangalawa, the accused shall be presumed innocent until the contrary is proved and shall enjoy the constitutional rights of the accused. Okay? Now, ang tanong, when can the accused be absent in trial? Okay? When can the accused be absent in trial? However, after arraignment, trial may proceed notwithstanding the absence of the accused, provided that he has been duly notified and his failure to appear is unjustifiable. Tatlo po ang requirements. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng arraignment? Ibig sabihin ng arraignment, binasa po ang krimen, ang accusation in front of you. Sa korte po yan nangyari. And after papagbasa, you will enter your plea whether you are guilty or not guilty. So sabihin mo, not guilty, Your Honor, or guilty, Your Honor. Mangyayari po dyan, ang mangyayari po yan sa arraignment. So, kailan ka pwedeng mag-absent sa trial? Number one, tapos na yung arraignment mo. Pangalawa, na-notified ka nga dapat may trial ngayon sa korte. May schedule kayo ngayon. But then again, you were absent. But you are notified. That's number two. Number three, yung absence mo is unjustifiable. For example, hindi ka lang pumunta. Ayaw mong pumunta. That's unjustifiable. Pero pag ang appearance or ang failure to appear is justifiable, justifiable po ha, for example, may sakit ka, terminal cancer, and you will be at the doctor on that specific day. Your reason is justifiable. So ano mangyayari? The trial should not proceed. Why? Because you have the justifiable reason. Pumunta ka sa doktor, you have a, I mean, you will undergo chemotherapy, and that's a very justifiable reason. In that case, the trial should not proceed. But if the reason is unjustifiable, you would say, I will just be absent because I have a stomach ache, I have a toothache, I have a headache. Lahat ng ik-ik mo sa buhay, ginawa mo ng alibi para makapag-absent sa trial. And that alibi are unjustifiable, the proceeding will go on, will proceed so long as it is after arraignment and you are already been notified. You can be absent. Okay? A public trial is not necessity, one to which the whole public is admitted. Ano ibig sabihin dito? Ibig sabihin that the trial should be public, it does not mean na lahat, pangkalahat na lang pwedeng pumunta. Napakaliit lang po ng courtroom. 'Di ba? May right po ang bawat accused, right to public trial. Pero hindi ibig sabihin diyan that every single citizen of the country will go, will participate on your trial. Hindi po pwede kasi yung courtroom natin napakaliit. Tapos yung sheriff has to maintain the peace and order of the court. Kung marami, napakagulo po. So ang ibig sabihin diyan, ang public trial po will connote that there will be people like those members of the immediate family, like your friends, your relatives, others who can be inside the court. Ang purpose po dyan, para nag-attend sila sa court, to see to it that justice is intelligently and impartially administered. Ano ibig sabihin na intelligently and impartially? Dapat po patas ang pag deliver ng justice. Yan po ang ibig sabihin ng a public trial. Now let's go po sa section 15. Ang section 15 po is the right to habeas corpus. Okay? Ano bang ibig sabihin ng writ of habeas corpus, 'di ba sa criminal law natin? Habeas corpus ibig sabihin to present the body, 'di ba? To present the body, habeas corpus. So, ibig sabihin ng writ, written po, writ, written, or written document. So, yung say, writ of habeas corpus po, this is an order of the court. Okay? Directed po yan sa police officer, yung arresting officer ha, who arrested somebody. Directed to a police officer, ordering him to present the person he arrested to court. Okay? Ordering him to present it in the court. The purpose of the writ of habeas corpus is to find out whether the arrest is considered to be justifiable or not. Kasi pag pumunta ka sa korte, let us say you are a police officer, wala ka nang magawa sa buhay, you just arrested someone because he is wearing a long jacket. Tapos sabihin mo, sir, in flagrante delicto, your honor, in flagrante delicto arrest. And the court will not agree to you, I tell you. There is what we call as arbitrary detention. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng arbitrary detention? Any public officer or employee who without legal grounds detains a person. Pwede po, criminal case po yan. So magka-problema po tayo. So dapat when you arrest someone, ikaw na police officer ka, dapat you should be mindful with the legalities. Surrounding the arrest. So, ang writ of habeas corpus is a document po ordering you to present the accused or the arrested person in court so that the court will know the grounds of his arrest. So, pag unlawful po, automatically the person will be released. Pero ang sabi ko, ang rebellion tsaka yung invasion is an exemption thereof. Why? Kasi pag, for example, during martial law, pag invasion tsaka yung may rebellion po, pwede po ang state or ang government maglagay sa tao in preventive imprisonment. Hindi po pwedeng ma-exercise niya ang writ of habeas corpus. Okay, but rather he will be placed in preventive imprisonment while waiting for investigation or trial. Ang section 16 po is again a repetition po sa constitutional rights of the accused. This is about the right to speedy trial. Okay, the right to speedy disposition of your cases before any judicial, quasi-judicial, or administrative bodies. So as I have said a while ago, in the Philippines, we have to consider also the workload of our judges. At the same time, the proof, burden of proof, or the evidences presented in the court, because the court cannot just decide easily without considering these aspects. On number 17, no person shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. This one is a protection against self-incrimination, which may expose a person to criminal liability. So pag magtanong po yung board exam natin about choices, and the question is about self-incrimination, ang isagot po natin yung section 17. Meaning, a person shall not be, has the right not to become a witness against himself. Ano po ba yung self-incrimination? When you say incrimination, inilagay mo po yung sarili mo sa sitwasyon as if that you committed it. But in reality, you do not. So, kahit ikaw ang nag-commit sa crime, you can invoke this right against self-incrimination. Ang number 18 po again is another repetition of the constitutional rights of the accused. Number 1, no person shall be detained solely by reason of his political beliefs and aspirations. So kahit anong color ka na political party, hindi mo pwede na maging prisoner ka just because of your political color. No involuntary servitude in any form shall exist upon except as a punishment for a crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted. Okay? Ano po bang ibig ng involuntary servitude? Baka lalabas to sa board exam. Ang involuntary servitude po, ibig sabihin yan, you are compelled, you are required to serve another. Okay? Because of a particular condition. A particular condition. Dalawa po ang klase dyan sa involuntary servitude. Ang una yung slavery, tapos yung pangalawa is peonage. Ang slavery po, ibig sabihin, you are entirely subjected to one's will of another. Ibig sabihin po, kung anong sabihin ng amo mo, pag sabihin ng amo mo na sumayaw ka, sumayaw ka, slave ka, slave ang position mo eh. Yan ang slavery. Entire subjection to one person. Pag sabihin ng amo na kumuha ka ng kahoy, mag-i-give ka ng tubig, you have to do it because you are under the entire subjection of the person. Hindi po pwede. Hindi po pwede yan because that is involuntary servitude. Pangalawa, yung peonage. Yung peonage po, the voluntary submission of a person or a peon. Ano ba yung peon? Yung nagpa-submit under the control of somebody. Because of a debt. Ang pagkaiba po ng slavery at peonage is that in peonage, may utang po na nakalagay. Pag may utang kasi, for example, 1 million, tapos pumunta ka sa bahay ng pinag-utangan mo, sabihin mo, mag-i-give na lang na ako ng tubig for 20 years until the 1 million will be paid in return of my services. Hindi po pwede. Tawag po dyan, peonage. And that is a form of involuntary servitude. And that is not allowed under the law. Pero may mga exceptions po tayo sa involuntary servitude. Again, ang involuntary servitude po, kahit ayaw mo, dapat you have to serve because of a condition. Pero may exception po tayo. For example, punishment for a crime. You will serve in the prison. And that is not involuntary servitude. That is legal. Pangalawa, yung civil or military service as required for citizens for the defense of the state. For example, nagka-World War III tayo. Tapos kailanganin ng military service mo. So it's not, that cannot be considered as involuntary servitude. Another, injunctions requiring striking laborers to return to work pending settlement of a dispute. Naging empleyado ka, tapos nag-strike kayo. Tapos sabihin nyo, sa inyong strike, you will not go to work for 1 month as a form of strike. Hindi po pwede. May mga injunctions po yan, may penalty. Pag sabihin ng employer, pag hindi ka pumunta, you will be terminated. Tapos pumunta ka, hindi, ibig sabihin doon, involuntary servitude. Why? Because there is a pending settlement. Kailangan may pending settlement for the dispute. Military and naval enlistment, exempted din po yan. Yung mga magulang natin, yung parents natin, binigyan tayo ng trabaho, yung mga lazy dyan, mga indolent cadets, students, na ayaw magpasabi, ayaw tumulong sa gawaing bahay. I tell you, yung gawaing bahay po, exception din po yan ng involuntary servitude. Baka sabihin nyo sa mga magulang nyo, ma, hindi po pwedeng mag-igib ako ng tubig o hindi po pwedeng maghugas ako ng pinggan kasi andyan sa constitution, involuntary servitude eh. Ayaw kong mag-serve. Hindi po, exception po yan. Okay? So, yung exercising authority ng parents natin over household chores is exempted under involuntary servitude. So, pwede po, legal po. Kung ikaw ay magulang, binigyan mo ng task ang anak mo to do household chores, that is okay. That is not involuntary servitude. Exempted po yan. Last one is on the assistance in the protection of peace and order of the community to help or repair public highways and street. Tapos nagbayanihan kayo kasi napakadumi ng community niyo. Tapos nagbayanihan. Hindi po ibig sabihin yan involuntary servitude. Legal po yan dahil it is exempted under the law. Now, the section 19 is more on excessive fines, okay? Excessive fines on accused and the degrading punishment. Now, this is what I am talking a while ago. Part of the rights, constitutional rights of the accused would be to tell the authorities not to inflict inhumane punishment or capital punishment. Ang capital punishment po natin, when you say capital punishment, these are punishment wherein the punishment is death, kamatayan po. Wala na po tayo dyan. Diba sinasabi ko a while ago, wala na po tayong death penalty sa Pilipinas. Why? Meron po tayong Republic Act 7659 po yan. Republic Act 7659, tinatawag po yan death penalty law. Take note ha, Republic Act 7659, death penalty law. Pero mayroon din po tayong Republic Act number 9346. Ano po? Republic Act 9346. Ano po ba yung 9346 which was enacted in the year 2006? This is the law prohibiting on the imposition of death penalty. So basically, ang Republic Act number 9346 po, ito po ang batas na nag-abolish sa death penalty. Ano po ba ang batas na nag-abolish sa death penalty? Republic Act 9346. Sa Section 20, sa may utang dyan, sa may mahilig mangutang, here is the good news po. Paghilig kayong mangutang. No person shall be imprisoned for debt or non-payment of a poll tax. Ano ba yung debt? Any liability to pay money arising out of contract express or implied. No, ibig sabihin ng express, verbal lang po, implied. Pati implied or by writing or by contract. Utang po yan. Utang po. Yung poll tax naman, ibig sabihin dyan, buwis po yan on individuals residing on a territory. Okay? Buwis po. Whether you are citizens or not, you are living in a territory without regard to the property or occupation where you engage, may buwis po. Ang tawag dyan, poll tax. Now, Pag hindi po nakabayad, ano pong mangyari? Okay? Ano pong mangyari pag hindi po nakabayad? Ang sabi ng Constitution, hindi po dapat mapriso, maglagay sa jail or sa prisoan. Tuwang-tuwa siguro ang mga kadete dito na may maraming utang, may pinaghiram na malaki-laking pera sa classmate, tapos hindi nagbabayad. Oh, good news po sa inyo to. Pero ang bad news sa may utang ganito po. Pag may utang ka on a particular person, the court can actually order for your property to be the means of payment on behalf of the money you owed from the other individual. Yan po ang bad news. For example, may utang ka 50,000. Naging 10 years na lang, hindi ka pa nakabayad ng 50,000 mo. Pwede, ang utang will have to be paid upon the order of the court by means of your property. For example, may 10 hectares piece of land ka. Tapos ang 1 hectare is equivalent to 50,000 na. Example lang yan, ha? So meaning, ang 1 hectare will be taken away from you. And the 1 hectare will be given to the person you owed for money. Pag wala kang land, any property, motorcycle, vehicles, the house that you have will be taken away as a payment of your utang. Yan po ang bad news. But the good side is, no one will be imprisoned because of debt or poll tax. Now, kanina, I also mentioned about double jeopardy as one of the constitutional rights of the accused. Ito po ang right, okay, na makikita natin sa Section 21. No person shall be twice put in jeopardy. When you say jeopardy, harm. Ibig sabihin po, harm. Of punishment for the same offense, if an act is punished by a law, an ordinance, conviction, or acquittal, under either shall constitute a bar to another prosecution for the same act. So ano po ang ibig sabihin ng right against double jeopardy para maintindihan natin? This means that when a person is charged with an offense and the case is terminated, either dalawa po ha, ang basis for termination, number one, acquittal, number two, conviction, or in any other manner without the express consent of the accused, the latter cannot again be charged with the same or identical case. For example, you have been charged with slight physical injury. Tapos during trial, you have been convicted. Okay, the court found out that you are guilty beyond reasonable doubt. The next time around, when after you serve the sentence, the next time around, you can no longer be punished with the same offense. You cannot be charged with the same slight physical injury. Why? Because you already served the punishment. You are already in one jeopardy. Hindi na po pwedeng isa lang krimen, dalawa yung punishment. Hindi po pwede yan. Number two, kahit hindi ka na-punish, for example, acquitted ka lang, yung krimen is slight physical injury. Pagdating sa korte, acquitted ka, sabi ng korte, you are acquitted from punishment. So ano yung ibig sabihin ng acquitted? Ibig sabihin, hindi ka pwede pumunta sa prison, hindi ka ma-punished. Okay? In that case, since that is acquittal, the complainant cannot charge you again with the same crime or with identical case. Ano ba ang identical sa slight physical injury? Ang identical niya is serious physical injury. So acquitted ka, tapos sabihin ng complainant, okay, I will file, since you are acquitted in slight physical injury, I will file to the prosecution and this time, I will file serious physical injury. Similar in nature po yan. So, hindi po pwede. Why? Because ang accused po ay may right against double jeopardy. Ang tanong ngayon, what if ang kaso mo ay dismissed lang? Na-dismiss lang yung kaso. due to any reason at all. Pwede bang ma-invoke mo yung right against double jeopardy? For example, nag-file ng slight physical injury. Due to insufficiency of evidence, ang nangyari po, na-dismiss yung kaso kasi kulang yung ebidensya. Ang tanong, pwede pa bang ma-refile, ma-file again yung slight physical injury na kaso? Ang sagot po dyan is, pwede. Pwede. Pag lalabas ito sa board examination, dapat yan ang answer mo. Pwede. Bakit? Ang nakalagay sa Constitution, acquittal lang po at conviction. Ang nangyari sa iyo, dismiss, kaya pwede yang ma-reopen, ma-refile sa prosecution pillar. Why? Because dismissal yung ruling. Pero pag acquittal or convicted, hindi na po pwede. Another example, may kaso ka sa barangay. Tapos you already agreed in the barangay that you will pay, for example, yung kambing mo, your goat, damaged the Malunggay Tree of Pedro. Tapos ang agreement nyo, magbayad ka ng 1,000 pesos. Okay? Because of the damages. Tapos nagbayad ka, nasettle na yung dispute nyo sa barangay. Pero, yung complainant, pumunta pa rin dun sa prosecution para mag-file ng kaso. Similar to the case being settled in the barangay. Ano po mangyari dyan? Ang mangyari is, ang case will be automatically dismissed. It will not be entertained because the case was already settled in the barangay. Hindi po pwedeng isang krimen, dalawa yung punishment. Isang krimen, dapat isa lang yung punishment. Let us go to the last. Ito na po ang pinaka-last na right. Okay? Under the Bill of Rights, ito po ang number 22, pinaka-last. No exposed facto law or bill of attainder shall be enacted. Okay? For the criminology cadets who are into review right now, I think this is very, very, very familiar on your part. Ano po ba ang exposed facto law? Ano po ba ang bill of attainder? Ang exposed facto law will be any of the following. Number one, makes an act criminal, even committed before the passage of the law. For example lang po to. Hindi ka nag-helmet 2005, year 2005. Tapos year 2010, may law on mandatory helmet. Example lang po yan ha. 2005, hindi ka nag-helmet. Pagka 2010, may batas po na na-enact ang Congress on mandatory helmet law. Ang tanong, pwede ba mag-file ng case, mag-file ng complaint against you because you did not wear your helmet last 2005? The answer is no. Okay, that is not allowed because during the commission of the act, that act was not considered as a crime. Why? Because there was no law punishing it. Nolum crimen nolla poena sinilehe. There is no crime if there is no law. That's what we call as logomasi, the principle of logomasi. When you do not wear a helmet during 2005, there was no law. So it shall not be considered as a crime. Number two, aggravates a crime compared to when it was committed. For example, ang punishment ng slight physical injury ngayon is only 1 month imprisonment. Pagka the next year, naging 3 years na. Tapos convicted ka last year. Ano mangyari sa'yo? Ay hindi po pwedeng ma-aggravate. Kung ano yung sentensya mo in the previous, that should only be followed. Pero ang good thing dito, cadets, ganito. Pag ang crimen is, what do we call it? Minimized, reduced, mitigated. In terms of punishment, our laws are construed in favor of the accused. Example po, ang punishment natin ng slight physical injury, example lang po to ha, 1 month. Tapos the next year, may batas na nagsabi na ang punishment ng slight physical injury is only 5 days. So ano mangyari sa'yo? So ang mangyari is, the law will affect you. Why? Because it is in your favor. Yan po ang nangyari. It is on your favor. So pwede bang ma-apply sa'yo? Pwede. Pero pag ang batas ay nag-aggravate, hindi yan pwede. Why? Because it is not in favor of you. Ang point dito is, if the law is in favor with the accused, pwede po yang maka-affect or ma-implement or ma-apply sa iyong sarili. Next, changes the punishment and inflicts a greater punishment that is similar to the third. Alters the legal rules of evidence and receives less testimony from what the law originally required as to the time the offense was committed in order to convict the offender. Again, that is not in favor with the accused and that should not be allowed. So yun po ang exposed facto law. Okay? So ang exposed facto law is should not be made or should not be enacted. Ang exposed facto law is the law having a retroactive effect. Now, ang Bill of Attainder is a legislative act which inflicts punishment without a judicial trial. Hindi po pwede yan. Ha? Kailangan po, may due process tayo eh. So, hindi po pwede you just punish a person without the trial. Ang tawag po dyan, Bill of Attainder. Ang Bill of Attainder is not allowed under the Constitution. Note, if a punishment is less than death, ang tawag po dyan is bill of pains and penalties. Okay? Bill of pains and penalties. Now, yun na po ang 22 Bill of Rights. Okay? Mga karapatang pantao po na makikita natin sa Constitution under Article 3. Now, punta naman tayo sa mga karapatan ng mga tao under custodial investigation. I mentioned about this a while ago. Okay? Ang rights of persons under custodial investigation ay makikita po yan sa Republic Act 7438. Diyan po nakalista lahat ng karapatan on those persons under custodial investigation. Ano po ba ang ibig sabihin ng custodial investigation? Ang ibig po sabihin ng custodial investigation, invitation po yan, inviting a person, okay? Inviting a person who is investigated in the connection of an offense. Part na po yan ng custodial investigation. So dapat, ikaw na police officer, dapat mag-observe ka sa karapatan ng tao under custodial investigation. Una, shall at all times be assisted by a counsel. Ano po mangyari pag walang counsel, walang lawyer? If you will become a police officer cadets, pag nag-start ka na ng custodial investigation mo, mag-interrogate ka na. Nilagay mo yung tao sa interrogation room, pero wala ang kanyang lawyer, ang gagawin mo is ganito. This is according to the law. Do not proceed with the investigation. Do not proceed with the custodial investigation. You wait, you just detain the individual until the lawyer will arrive. Why? Because at all times, there should be an assistance of the counsel. Lagay mo yan sa kukote mo pag maging kardo dalisay ka. Pangalawa, Miranda rights. Okay, right to be informed of the cause and nature of accusation, the right to remain silent, the right to counsel, dapat you have to explain it. I tell you, do not memorize it. Dapat i-explain mo yan in a language known to the subject. Di kay para kang nag-flip top, di ba? Para ka lang nag-flip top, you just memorize it, hindi po pwede. Dapat you have to explain. Third one, yung custodial investigation report mo, dapat in writing po yan. Tapos, in writing, dapat na-explain po yan by the counsel of the accused. Then, after that, the explanation should be in a language known to the accused or otherwise, pag hindi yan na-explain, pag ang investigation report mo is not reduced into writing, wala na. Ang mangyari po, null and void na. Ano ibig sabihin ng null and void? Wala pong effect yan sa korte. Why? Hindi ka nag-follow sa procedure. Number four, ang lahat ng extrajudicial confession should be in writing. Sinabi ko na kanina, it should be in writing, signed by the person, the confessant, in the presence of the council in a language known to him, and it should be voluntary. Kasi pag hindi yan voluntary, kasi nilagay mo yung tao in a solitary confinement, tapos gumawa ka ng mga gestures para ma-intimidate yung tao, ang mangyari po dyan, null and void, maging fruit of the poisonous tree yan. And number five, any waiver sa right niya. Like for example, he will confess, that is our waiver of the right to remain silent. Lahat po ng waiver niya dapat in writing. Okay? Any waiver of a person should be in writing and should be signed in the presence of the council. Pag hindi po yan nangyari, wala yung council, hindi po in writing, in a language known to the subject, patay. Ang waiver niya maging null and void pa din. So dapat you have to follow. The next one, the person under custodial investigation or under detention has the right to be visited by the immediate family, the medical doctors, the priest, the council, the national non-government organization accredited by the Commission on Human Rights, pwede po. Ang tanong ngayon, ano ba ang ibig sabihin ng immediate family, sir? Ang immediate family po, ang sabi ng Constitution, ito po yung fiancé. Kasali po yung fiancé, meaning hindi pa kasal. Yung spouse, yung partner mo sa buhay, yung parent, your child, brother, sisters, grandparent, grandchild, uncle, aunt, nephew, niece, guardian, ward, all of these are considered as immediate family. Take note again, custodial investigation shall include mere invitation to the person being investigated. Sunod, punta naman tayo sa women and children's right. Okay, marami po tayong batas dito. Pero hindi po natin i-discuss to one by one, kasi if we will do this, this will take for eternity. Okay? Pero familiarize na lang natin yung mga laws on women and children's rights. Memorize nyo na lang po, baka lalabas sa board exam. Una, Civil Code of the Philippines, Family Code, Labor Code, PD603. Lumabas po yan sa 2010 board examination. Child and Youth Welfare Code po yan. Pati yung 9262, the Anti-Violence Against Women and Children. Okay, RA 9262. Child Protection Act, yung RA 7610. Juvenile Justice and Welfare Act, ito po, lumabas 2015. Republic Act 9344 po yan. Ang Magna Carta for Women, lumabas din po. Republic Act 9710, tsaka yung Abolition of Death Penalty, Republic Act 9346. But we will just go with the salient rights of the Filipino children under PD603. Ang Child and Youth Welfare Code ay nag-enumerate po yan ng 12 rights of the Filipino children, which are very self-explanatory. Una po, every child has the right to be born well. Ano pong ibig sabihin nito? Ang magulang po ay having the responsibility to provide yung safe environment, healthy environment for the unborn child. Okay? That's what we call as right number one. Right number two, every child has the right to a wholesome family life. So, ibig sabihin po nito, ang learning environment po ng mga bata is yung tahanan natin, yung pamilya natin. They are entitled to have a loving family that will instill values and morals in them. Okay? Pangatlo, every child has the right to be raised well and become contributing members of society. May responsibilidad po ang magulang na dapat i-mold yung mga bata on how to become productive in the society. Number four, the child or every child has the right to basic needs. Ito po, ang DSWD is very, very prompt on this. Dapat po na-meet nyo ang right na ito. Kasi kapag hindi, ang DSWD will intervene and will take the custody of the child from you. So dapat po, basic needs ha? Ang basic needs are the following po. Balanced diet. Ano po bang ibig sabihin ng balanced diet? Dapat hindi malnourished. Adequate clothing. May shelter po, may bahay, and proper health care. Okay? Yan po ang ibig sabihin ng number 4. Sa number 5 po, every child has the right to access what they need to have a good life. So, in order to build and strengthen their character in adulthood, there should be a support coming from the people around them. Because that is one of their rights. Number 6, right, every child has the right to education. So, responsibilidad po ng mga magulang to bring the child into school institutions. Hindi po pwedeng sabihin natin na tapos ka ng naluwal, andyan ka na, dapat you have to look for means for you to be educated in using your own self-effort. Hindi po pwede. Dapat you have a responsibility to take as a parent. Number 7, to enjoy, right to play and enjoy their youth. So hindi po pwedeng lahat, trabaho na lang, di ba? Trabaho na lang. Di ba? Yung mga makarelate yan, tulad ko ng mga pobre, ako po nung bata po is very poor. Instead of playing, andun po ako, nagtatrabaho. Kumukuha ng panggatong, fetching water, cleaning the house, all of this. And wala na pong time to enjoy, okay? And to play. So dapat po kasi ang lahat ng bata should have this right, should exercise this right. Because after all, children, as to their nature, is into playing and enjoyment. Every child has the right to be protected from danger. Either the danger is physical, mental, and emotional state. Number 9, every child has the right to live in a productive environment. That means they have to be away from bad influences. Okay? Especially yung mga nasa areas na congested na. Usually, hindi po siya conducive for the nurturing of children. Number 10 po, the right to be cared in the absence of their parent or guardian. So pag wala pong parent, walang guardian, sino ang mag-take over? Hindi ang DSWD or Department of Social Welfare and Development. So pag walang magulang, walang guardian, so dapat ang government will take over. The right to good governance. So even though they cannot participate on voting, so the government should exhibit good governance that will inspire children to become productive and helpful. And the last one, the right to freedom and peace. Okay, so this should be away from conflicts. Okay, because if they are inside the conflict zone, that can affect their psychological aspect. Ito po yung mga rights ng children po natin na makikita natin sa PD603. Punta naman tayo sa rights of cultural minorities. Ano po ba ibig sabihin ng cultural minorities? Ito po yung mga ethnic group or indigenous cultural communities or ICC or indigenous people po. Take note po kadate sa Republic Act number 8371. Okay? This is the law that protect and promote the indigenous cultural community. Also, sa batas na to, may nagawa po, may na-establish na isang agency. Ang agency po na to, ang tinatawag nating NCIP. Ano po ba yung NCIP? NCIP stands for National Commission on Indigenous People. Ang ahensya po ito ng gobyerno ang siyang mag-implement sa lahat ng mekanismo para sa betterment ng ating cultural minorities. So, ano po ang batas na nag-create sa NCIP? 8371. Republic Act 8371. Now, Marami po ang karapatan ng cultural minorities, but what I will be doing is to discuss only the salient ones, yung pinaka-importante. Okay? And I want you to familiarize these cadets. Okay? Okay? I want you to familiarize this. Una, yung rights to ancestral domain. Ano po bang ibig sabihin ng ancestral domain? Ito po yung mga areas belonging to the indigenous cultural community or ICC or the indigenous people or IPs. Ito po yung lands, inland, water, coastal areas and natural resources therein. So may karapatan po ang mga ethnic group over ancestral domain ng mga ito. Pati na yung mga ancestral land. Okay? Pati na yung mga ancestral land. So, ang ownership po and position of the ICCs and IPs will be protected, should be protected and be recognized by the government. Sir, ano pang pinagkaiba ng ancestral domain tsaka yung ancestral land? Ang ancestral land po refers to the land occupied, possessed, and utilized by individual families and clans who are members of the ICCs or the IPs. So, ibig sabihin po, ito po yung area where they are living. Yung physical area po, yung land from point A to point B. Pero ang ancestral domain po, part na po dito ang tinatawag na ancestral land. Kasi yung ancestral lands is only those areas where they live, where they are residing. Ancestral domain, hindi lang yung ancestral land, pati na yung tubig, coastal areas, natural resources sa kanya yan. So meaning, mas malaki yung ancestral domain kaysa ancestral land. Kasi yung ancestral domain is only, ancestral land rather, is only part of the ancestral domain. Now aside from that, yung cultural minorities po natin, may right to self-governance po and empowerment po din sila. Now aside from those, yung cultural minorities po natin also has the right to self-governance and empowerment. This refers to governing themselves and determination in respect to their values, practices, and institutions. So, dapat irespeto po natin. Mayroon din po silang karapatan to participate in decision-making, especially if ang topic po is improvement sa kanilang community. Dapat sila po ang may final say. Right to determine and decide priorities for development. So dapat pag ang development po sa government will affect the cultural minorities, dapat sila po ang masunod. Because that is protected under Republic Act 8371. Next, aside from that, may rights din po sila during armed conflict. Dapat po protected sila under the law. Protected po sila. For example, yung NPA ngayon, di ba, usually exploited the ethnic group. Hindi po pwede. Freedom from discrimination and equal opportunity and treatment. Kahit ano ka, ita ka man, bukid nun ka man, kahit anong ethnic group that you have, badjaw ka man, dapat we have the same, they have the same opportunities. And there shall be no discrimination. In fact po, in the Philippine National Police application, there is a specific quota. Mayroon po tayong batas dyan, exclusive for the IPs. Okay? For example, hindi ka nakaabot ng height. Diba ang height natin ngayon is 5'2 for the male, 5'2 flat for the female. Tapos, miyembro ka ng IPs or ICCs. Then, even if your height does not meet the requirement, you can still apply. You shall be qualified. Next, yung intellectual rights, yung practice nila sa kanilang kultura at tradisyon at mga kostumbre, may karapatan din po. Pati na yung religious, cultural sites and ceremonies. Yun po ang lahat ng mga karapatan ng mga ICCs or the IPs. Now, ang NCIP under Section 38 of Republic Act 8371, malaki po ang role niya. Bakit? Kasi ito lang po ang ahensya ng gobyerno who will be supervising on the implementation of the policies programs of the government. Sino? Ang NCIP or National Commission on Indigenous Cultural Communities or Indigenous People. So meron po tayong chapter dito sa Negros. I think one time we have in Bayawan City. The office was in Bayawan City. I don't know if right now it's still in Bayawan. But the NCIP office was there a long time ago. So, yun po ang responsibility ng NCIP. Now, punta naman tayo sa tinatawag nating deprive of liberty, yung PDL natin. Kanina, rights of the accused, not yet convicted pa po yun. Ito convicted na talaga, nasa prison na. So, anong mangyari? Marami din po silang karapatan na dapat i-observe natin. Makikita nyo yan sa screen. Human manner of treatment, fair trial, legal assistance, right against cruel and inhuman or degrading punishment, right to be kept in official government prison. It should not be in a private, ha? Dapat government prison po ang nakalagay dyan. Right to appear in public before legally constituted court, right to a prison program which enhances their intellectual and social abilities. Right to separate living arrangement in prison according to categories. Take note of this. I will concentrate on paragraph J. Sa prison po, may tinatawag na tayo na classification. Diba, cadets? Under institutional correction subject po ito, but I have to discuss this. Ang classification system refers to the process of arranging the prisoners or the PDL into age, gender, security, all of those. So, hindi po pwede na ang babae will have to be integrated with the male. Hindi po pwede na ikaw na 1 month ang punishment will have to be integrated on life imprisonment individuals. Hindi po pwede na ang detainee will have to be integrated with the convicted individuals kasi may right po sila. Okay? Right po. So dapat pare-pareho. Babae sa babae, lalaki sa lalaki. Same with the age. Same with the reason of imprisonment. Same with the level of security. Yan po ang ibig sabihin ng paragraph G. Now, again, on H, paragraph H is related to G. Again, dapat po separated ha, ang detainee at saka yung convicted. Tapos, right to communicate, the right to legal assistance. All of these are basically the rights of the persons deprived of liberty. Ang tanong ngayon, sino ang dapat mag-supervise if these rights are observed by the government? Walang iba kundi ang tinatawag nating CHR or the Philippine Commission on Human Rights, 'di ba? The enemy of the president, 'di ba? Ang CHR po is an independent autonomy po 'yan. Okay, may autonomy po, meaning independent po 'yan. It is created under the Philippine Constitution. Now, ang function po ng Commission on Human Rights is to investigate all forms of human violation, whether it is civil or political rights in the Philippines. Extrajudicial killing po, pwede po yan ma-investigate sa human rights. Okay? Now, ang human rights po natin sa Pilipinas, may mga powers and functions po yan. Sinasabi ko na kanina that they can investigate all forms of human rights violations, civil or political. Now, ang pangalawa po, pwede po silang mag-cite ng contempt. For example, police officer ka, pinasomon ka, you are required to appear before the CHR, but you did not appear in the CHR. Problema po, kasi pwede pong maikontempt ka. Pangatlo po, yung CHR po, pwede din po makabigay ng legal assistance to our brothers and sisters in abroad. So long as you are Filipinos, and or those individuals who are underprivileged. For example, you have been maltreated by a police officer during investigation. So pwede pong pumunta ng CHR, and the CHR will give you legal assistance. Aside from that, ang CHR po, or Commission on Human Rights, may tinatawag po siyang visitorial power. Ano po ba yung visitorial power? Ang visitorial power is the authority of the Commission on Human Rights para bisitahin yung mga jails, prison, and detention facilities to find out if these facilities are in consonance with the standard. Problema po yung mga district jail dyan na hindi nag-comply. District jail or municipal or city jail na overcrowded po. So the CHR can investigate on this. Okay? They can investigate on this. Next, research. Continuing program on research education. Respecting about human rights. Pwede din po recommend to Congress effective measures to promote human rights. Aside from that, mayroon pa po, i-monitor ng CHR ang compliance ng government sa international treaty. Diba? Sabi ko in episode 1, marami po tayong agreement. Marami po tayong conventions where we are signatory of. So mag-monitor po ang CHR kung ang government po ba nag-comply po ba sa mga provisions sa ating mga treaties. Pati na yung grant of immunity from prosecution. Whose testimony or whose position of evidence is necessary for the determination of truth? Ano po ba yung grant of immunity? Ibig sabihin po ng immunity, hindi po pwedeng mailagay ka sa prisuan. Hindi po pwedeng ma-accuse ka on a particular crime. Bakit? Immune ka kasi eh. Nabigyan ka ng immunity. Isa po yan sa power ng CHR. Number 9 po, request the assistance of any independent bureau office in the performance of its function. For example, ipatawag yung police officer. Pwede ba to assist on the functions of the CHR? The answer is yes. Pwede po yan. Bakit? Simply because nakalagay po yan sa Constitution. So you are obliged to follow. Number 10 po, appoint its officers and employees in accordance with the law and perform such other duties and functions as may be provided by the law. Yun po ang mga functions natin sa Commission on Human Rights. Independent body po yan, tsaka may autonomy po. So nobody can touch the CHR because it is an independent body. Like, hindi po siya under sa executive. Independent po siya, like the Commission on Election. Cadets na nagre-review right now sa old at saka sa new curriculum, maraming salamat po in listening to this discussion. Isa lang po ang appeal ko. In studying po, kailangan po, we have to pray always. Before you study, you have to pray. After you wake up, the very first thing that you have to do is to pray. Because without divine intervention, cadets, ang mangyayari po sa atin, pag wala ang Panginoon, wala din po tayo. So dapat mag-pray tayo when we study. And I am hoping po, nakapagbigay po ako ng liwanag, a little amplification of your knowledge, so that once you take the board examination, you can utilize this all. Marami po ang lalabas dito kasi ang lahat ng topics na na-discuss ko ay in consonance po sa CHED at sa PRC, sa course description nila. So, posibleng marami po ang lalabas. Sa description po, mayroon pong instruction dyan. Bibigay po ako ng free PDF, a copy of this discussion. If you want to grab a copy, just follow the instruction. So, I'm hoping upcoming criminology licensure examination, you can handle it. And you will return back to me. Maybe you can say thanks for helping you in your venture. But I want you to, as much as possible, give thanks to the Lord first. Because without the Lord, we are nothing. Thank you so much. God bless you and enjoy learning. And I hope you will pass the board exam. Thank you.